Listen, beloved, we welcome you to another exciting week on The Voice of Resurrection. I'm excited about this week because it illustrates practically the power of consecration. We want to study Balaam and Balak to see what the word of the Lord was about Israel. And it is the same reality in our own lives when we keep that state of consecration unto the Lord our God. We pick up this study from Numbers chapter 23, verse 14. And he brought him into the field of Zophim, to the top of Pisgah, and built seven altars, and offered a bullock and a ram on every altar. And he said unto Balak, stand here by thy burnt offering, while I meet the Lord yonder. And the Lord met Balaam and put a word in his mouth. Hallelujah. May the Lord put a word in my mouth today for you. May the Lord put a word in your mouth today for all your friends on the job and your employees, if you're an employer, and your supervisor and co-workers. May the Lord put a word in your mouth this morning. Hallelujah. And said, go again unto Balak, and say thus. And when he came to him, behold, he stood by his burnt offering, and the princes of Moab with him. And Balak said unto him, what hath the Lord spoken? That is the question we must learn to ask in our generation. What has the Lord spoken? Because all kinds of craziness going on today. There are all kinds of philosophies. There are all kinds of things people are attributing to the scriptures that don't even exist. What hath the Lord spoken, beloved? You're making that decision. You're trying to make such a big move in business and you're focused on money. What has the Lord spoken? It's all about consecration unto the Lord. Your consecration is to him, not to what you want, not covetousness, not money, not willing and dealing, not business, not anything. Hallelujah. Like my friend shared the testimony, how he was just about to sign this deal that will make billions. And the Lord gives him a vision for him to see the spiritual state of the one he was going into business with. And he just couldn't sign it. He saw himself in a diplomatic class in royal priesthood, and they saw this guy with filthy garments and in another realm altogether. Consecration, beloved, is walking away from millions, knowing that the Lord has spoken not to. Consecration, beloved, that's our power. If you're consecrated, there's nothing the enemies of God can do. I'll talk about this, and I want to talk about Daniel and some others before I finish today, this week, that is. It is so powerful. Listen to this. It says, he said, what hath the Lord spoken? And he took up his parable and said, rise up, Balak, and hear. Hearken unto me, thou son of Zippor. God is not a man that he should lie, neither the son of man that he should repent. Hath he said, and shall he not do it? Or hath he spoken, and shall he not make it good? Behold, I have received commandment to bless, and he had blessed, and I cannot reverse it. Glory to God. Did you hear what I read, beloved? This is the blessing. This is the inheritance of true children of God. You see, in our generation, we are confused. What is that confusion? We think that God thinks like men. We think that majority carries the vote. We think that secular humanism and a secular society and a democracy would dictate spiritual destiny. I find that ludicrous and funny. God is not a man. Ooh, I preached this in a Bible study, and I pondered that for, my God, I don't know how long. God is not a man. My wife told me, hey, maybe complete that statement, because people can run off and say, you said that God is not a man, so I'm saying he's a woman, because this generation again is confused. He's saying God is not a human being, okay, if that helps. He's not a human being. He's a spirit. What did the book of John say? It said, God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. He's not a man. Watch this, that he should lie. Think about all the areas where you are afraid. You believer, you preacher, you anointed one. When the Lord has already made you a promise, why is your stress level so high? You are not consecrated from your problems. You consecrate to the Lord and from everything else. I know one time at the first consecration series we did, I said, consecrating your pride. And my brother was telling me, there's nothing good in pride. There's no way you can consecrate your pride. But I was saying, surrender your pride to the Lord in consecration, if that helps. You see, he said he's not a man that he should lie. Many times I've been embarrassed. Like when somebody brought up some paper that says that the church has to move from his location, that Fulton County has mapped out a tax assessment district, TAD. And the decision has made that the church had to move. So how can God work a miracle, change a 100-year-old law, bless us, pay off our debts, and we're debt-free, and then we will move. Beloved, I started praying, and I started praying all night the first night. You know, I didn't hardly sleep, and I went to work the next day and came home, and I'm praying in the middle of the night, and God thundered at me with such irritation. I said, I have given you the building. I was shocked back into reality. I turned over and I didn't apologize. I repented. And I pulled the cover and went for it. You can see when you haven't slept in 2 days. My God, you could have measured the sonic boom of my snoring down the street. Hallelujah. I went for it and rested. He's not a man that he should lie. You don't make promises and then change. You need to surrender your fear today. You need to surrender your stress today. You need to surrender all these things. He's not a man. What have the Lord spoken? That's what you should be asking yourself. I'm digging in and they say, I gotta go. Come on, hold that thought till tomorrow. We love you. See you tomorrow. Bye-bye.